like that.
Welcome. This is the meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. It's a regular meeting number 15 of the 97-98 year. It's Monday, April 13th. We might not agree on everything tonight, but I'm sure we can all agree it was a beautiful day.
Thank you.
You're here.
So it's always nice to start on a positive note. With that, we'll have a roll call by the town clerk.
Chairman Graff.
Here.
Counselor Barry.
Here.
Counselor Byer.
Present.
Counselor Fritz.
Here.
Counselor Jordan.
Yep.
Counselor McGinty.
Here.
And Counselor Reed.
Here.
The Pledge of Allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Is there any citizen that wishes to discuss any matter that is not on the agenda tonight?
Mr. Chairman, as a citizen, just quickly, I received the county budget. If anybody is interested in reviewing the budget, I served on a county budget committee at that level. Perhaps I could leave this with the clerk. Is that an appropriate place? So that if any of the citizens want to look over the county budget, it'll be in the town hall at the clerk's office.
That's fine. Thank you.
All right.
Reports and correspondence. Any members of the town council?
I guess that's where it should have been.
We don't worry about those small things.
I had one when you get a chance.
I've been advised on a couple things. One, I would like to congratulate the middle school students who and their teacher, Mr. Price, who put on a magnificent musical this last week. It was an amazing amount of work, and it was so much fun to watch. I actually saw it twice, and I certainly appreciate all that time and effort. Also, Cape Elizabeth Little League is having a fundraiser this year that they've rented out to the Portland Players at 420 Cottage Road for a performance of Damn Yankees. It's on June 18th at 8 o'clock, and that might be a fun evening. Mr. McGovern?
Yeah, I just wanted to update the town council and the public as well on the bottle drive that was held this last Saturday. Some of you may have seen the signs or may have gotten a knock on your door. The town employees this past weekend from all the different departments, some of the firemen as well, just about 30 something people all together, some spouses of employees, went door to door in Cape Elizabeth collecting bottles and cans for the Ray Lynn Williams Fund. Ray Lynn is the daughter of Hap Williams, Bob Williams, the captain of our Engine 1 Fire Company, as well as a full-time employee in Public Works. And his daughter was recently treated in Nebraska and had a bone marrow transfer as part of that. It was very expensive. While health insurance picks up most of the health insurance costs, there have been lots of other costs that aren't assumed by insurance. So anyway, the employees agreed last month that they'd like to put on a bottle drive, and it actually happened yesterday. And very pleased that the citizens of Cape Elizabeth donated bottles and cans and cash of over $1,800 to this bottle drive. And I want to thank the employees, thank particularly Forrest King of the Department of Public Works who coordinated it, and particularly thank the citizens of Cape Elizabeth who were extremely generous with their nickels and dime and 15-cent returns, as well as of that amount, there was over $500 in cash donated as well. So really do appreciate the effort of employees and the contribution of the citizens.
Are there any other reports and or correspondence? Councilor McGinty.
I wonder if we might get the town manager to update us on the homestead tax exemption, where we stand with that in the forms. Yes, thank you, Councilor McGinty. As everyone has probably read in the newspaper, the legislature this past session approved a homestead exemption, exempting the first $7,000 worth of property value to every resident property owner in Cape Elizabeth. There's no income guidelines. The only requirements is that you have to be at least a resident of the state of Maine for at least a year, and that you had to live in your current house as of April 1st of 1998. you are ineligible if you're a non-resident. Some folks now are registered to vote or pay their taxes in Florida instead of in Maine, or if you have a summer home here in Cape Elizabeth. It's only your principal residence. But anyway, it appears to be a very good program. We now have applications available in the town office, but would really encourage everyone to wait just a few days. We expect to have them in the mail within the next week, delivered to every home in Cape Elizabeth, and the deadline will then be May 15th. So as of this point in time, you can wait to receive it, which will be in the next week or so. You can come in to get it. You could also download it off of the internet through the State of Maine homepage. And also, there's a link as well in www.portland.com, which is the newspaper link. But that is available, and would encourage everyone to apply for it. It won't actually be cash given out as part of the program, but everyone who does apply will get an actual reduction in their tax bill for the exact amount of the tax break. It's estimated to be around $135 for every Cape Elizabeth homeowner.
Councilor Jordan.
Yes, is that over and above a veteran's?
Yes, it is. That's the veteran's exemption is an additional exemption. And also the circuit breaker program will also be continuing, which is based on income levels. And those applications will be available later this year.
Are there any other reports and correspondence? Hearing none. Next is my favorite part of the program, presentations. Tonight is the Nordic Ski Team. Their coaches are Annie and John Upton, and I'll meet you at the podium. And any members of the team that are here too? Come on right over here. Come on in.
Great. Thanks.
Welcome. Well, we have a proclamation tonight. It's Town of Cape Elizabeth, Town Council Proclamation, Nordic Skiing, a Maine State Championship. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth Boys Nordic Ski Team recently competed in the state championship meet, and whereas Nordic skiing is one of the best lifelong recreational opportunities that enhances good fitness and good health. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth boys earned a first place tie in the Nordic portion of the Maine Class B State Championship ski meet. And whereas this victory came about in only the third year of interscholastic competition in Nordic skiing for Cape Elizabeth High School now, therefore, the Cape Elizabeth Town Council does hereby congratulate the Cape Elizabeth Boys Nordic Champions, their coaches, Annie and John Upton, and all others who have contributed to the development of an active Nordic program in our community, and all signed by all members of the Town Council. Way to go, coaches.
Thank you very much.
Way to go, guys.
Thank you very much. On behalf of the Nordic Ski Team, we have four of our skiers here today, and
five.
They're participating in spring sports, so it's difficult to get them all here and play activities, but they're very accomplished skiers, and we had a great season for their third year, and we do appreciate the town support. Thank you.
Next item is minutes of the previous meetings. Is there a motion?
I move they be accepted as printed.
Second?
Second.
All in favor? Item number 126, receipt of the report of the pool study committee. My understanding is that the chair of the committee, David Sear, is here. I would like to say before you start that I went to the first meeting. This was a very hard-working group, and it's only because citizens, like the citizens on this committee, are willing to give their time and effort that we live in a community with so many wonderful things happening. So thank you ahead of time from the town council for this report, and we will enjoy hearing from you.
Great. Thank you very much, Joe. My name's David Sear. I live at 15 Macaulay Road in Cape Elizabeth, and I'm here to represent the Pool Building Committee as the chair of that committee. The committee was formed in 1997 and has been meeting since approximately last September to develop a specific proposal to renovate and improve the Donald Richards Pool. The committee was also charged with assembling information on the extent of the pool usage and to consider the effects of the pool renovations on pool activities that are going or existing at the pool facility. I'm pleased to present to you tonight the Donald Richards Pool Study Committee report, which I understand has already been mailed to you, and we have some extra copies available should anyone need one. Other members of the pool committee are here in attendance tonight. In fact, at last count, I think there are seven or eight pool committee members, including Mr. Beyer, who are here, and then folks from Harriman Associates, which is the engineering firm hired by the town to provide technical expertise to the committee as well as to help prepare the report. And I guess I would be remiss if I didn't recognize Varney Hintland's work in helping compile this report. He did yeoman's work in that regard, so he should be recognized for that. Before turning the podium to Harriman Associates for their technical review of the options, I'd like to take the time to perhaps point out three things that I would like to have the council consider while they're reviewing the report and reviewing this issue generally over the next few months. First, there's a fundamental shift that has occurred in the way that we traditionally think about pools, at least in the way the committee has thought about this pool renovation effort. And that shift is that in years past, we've always referred to the pool as a high school pool used largely for competitive purposes. However, the committee has looked at this pool in a more expansive way to look at it as a wellness center that would provide broad community support in the area of recreation, educational competition, and also for therapeutic applications. So when you look at this report, I would ask and request that you look at it in this broader context than the old traditional way of looking at it. The second point I'd like to make is that the existing pool is in pretty bad shape, and maybe that's an understatement for any of you who have actually been in there. The locker rooms are just in dismal condition. And we've found from our technical experts that the pool itself is in need of some significant repairs. We have outlined a timeline in the report that provides for building the renovations and repairs as well as the enhancements that we're recommending to the pool by December of 1999, but that process basically starts today. And we're encouraging an accelerated timeline by the end of 1999 to address all of the problems that have been identified in the report, as well as to make this facility available to the broader community as soon as possible. The final point I'd like to raise is that the committee evaluated different pool options, ranging from closing the pool, which is roughly $500,000 option, to building a brand new pool from the ground up, which is roughly a $5.5 million option. And we've landed somewhere below the midpoint of that range at a $2.2 million option. There are two viable options. One is referred to in the report as option C, and the second is referred to as option D. Option C is the option that basically fixes what's there today, so it's sort of a like-kind replacement, fairly extensive at that, but like-kind replacement nevertheless, with some enhancements, but not extensive enhancements, and that's roughly $1.6 million in terms of the total price tag on that option. The second option, which is the one that the committee is recommending I'll use the word strongly. I'll speak on behalf of the committee recommending strongly, and that's option D. And option D is a $2.2 million option, and that option extends the or expands the facility to include a weight room, a whirlpool, and also for expanded seating. And that option is desirable because it addresses all of the safety issues that have been addressed by the pool committee and its technical experts. And I'd like to point out that as an important consideration, the $600,000 incremental amount to take you from option C at $1.6 million to option D at $2.2 million, we have identified sufficient revenues to offset the incremental cost, the incremental annual cost of that second option. So basically, we view that as a zero-sum game to get to that next level, to get to the $2.2 million. The folks from Harriman Associates are here to talk about the technical aspects of the pool, and I'd like to turn the presentation over to them, and then following that, if you have any questions, we'd be happy to entertain them. And I have this evening Patrick Costin, who I guess will be giving the presentation, and then Eric Craven, who is with that firm as well, is here to provide support.
Thank you very much.
Good evening. I'm an architect with Harriman Associates. I've been involved with this project for about 18 months now, starting with a pool study that was originally commissioned to identify the existing conditions of the pool itself and the associated facilities, and have carried through into the subsequent report, which is making recommendations for improvements. Primarily, we want to focus attention on the safety issues that are associated with the condition of the pool as we know it today. We did extensive testing of the structure of the facility, the pool basin and the surrounding deck areas, to determine the extent of deterioration that's been caused by chlorine over the past 25 years. And we've discovered some very serious deterioration that threatens the pool's existence. We believe that there's perhaps 3 to 5 years of life left in this facility before you would be forced to close it for safety reasons. The two options that have been referred to earlier include, as a primary consideration, replacing the entire pool basin structure. Both of those options will involve removing the entire concrete structure that's within the pool area and the associated decks around the pool area and putting in a brand new pool. Beyond that, the differences are something I'd like to highlight. The option D, which the committee is focusing on as their recommendation, would address two other major concerns that have been identified in the studies that we've done that are deficiencies. One is spectator seating, and the second is a filter room, and actually I'd add a third, which is a weight room area. Part of the reason why the pool structure has deteriorated to the point that it has is because the original design of the pool included a below-grade filter room, which and an HVAC system or ventilating system, which impregnated the decks and the pool basin with chlorine. What that does over time, in simple terms, it makes the steel that reinforces the concrete corrode, and that causes the concrete to fail by losing strength. We propose to address that by eliminating the below-grade filter room and building a new above-grade filter room, so that with the new structure, you would never again be faced with the kind of deterioration that exists today in the existing structure. Another problem that was identified is a series of traffic issues which are associated with spectator seating. Currently, because hallways are blocked by a weight room and by storage functions, both users of the pool and spectators who come to see events are crossing the pool deck. This is another very serious safety issue, both from the standpoint of people slipping and falling, but also from a maintenance standpoint, with people in street shoes crossing this deck area. We propose to solve that problem in option D by creating a separate weight room and a spectator seating area that would have its own circulation and would eliminate people crossing the deck area in order to access either the pool locker rooms to use them or to watch an event. Beyond that, the other major component that we're trying to address is the condition of the locker rooms. The locker rooms have deteriorated to the point where they are no longer sustainable in terms of just a cosmetic redo. They have suffered some of the same effect that I described in the pool area from a high humidity environment causing the materials in those locker rooms to deteriorate over time. So we're proposing to remove, essentially gut the locker rooms and rebuild them. With all those three components, we think that we'll provide you with a pool that will meet the needs that the committee identified that the community has to make this a very effective pool facility. With that, I would ask if there are any questions for any of us who are here.
Pat?
Hi.
We worked together on the committee immediately preceding this, and one of the questions I had then, and I'd like to raise it now, is does option D take care of the chlorinated smell that filters currently into the high school?
Yes, it does. We identified, and this report emphasizes that, we identified some problems with the existing mechanical system that exists in the pool area, which is taking pool air and pumping it to elsewhere in the building. We would create separate mechanical systems for, we would separate the pool mechanical systems from the rest of the school in this renovation so that that condition would be corrected.
And by doing that, people like me and Billy Jordan, who have asked for years about the separation of the pool from the school department's budget, all of those can be accomplished with, in part, these systems being changed over at this time?
We're proposing currently, yes, to have, for example, the boiler, which currently serves the rest of the high school, is also serving the pool area. We would provide a new boiler that would service only the pool area itself.
And just so the audience will know, that means we don't have to heat the high school all summer, so the water in the pool will be hot?
That's correct.
Thank you.
For the public at large, the plan, as in many of these reports, is to receive the report tonight, and then if there's a motion, and with the consent of the town council, it is anticipated that there will be a workshop. The public will certainly, as in everything we do, be invited to attend that workshop. This is a large expenditure, proposed expenditure for the town, and obviously there's no decision being made on this item tonight. This is the start of a process that I don't mean to cut off any town councilors that have any questions tonight, but I wanted to make sure everybody knew that tonight is not a decision night. Tonight is not even a night where all the information about this project is going to be discussed. It's the beginning. So, are there any councilors with any questions? Councilor Byer.
Yes. Yes, thank you, Joe. I should, before a questioning, I should point out that as I was a member of this committee, so it is not out of ignorance that I'm asking questions, but I would like to make sure that, particularly for the folks that are at home, there are two points that are clearly underlined. And the first one, Pat, I think probably you're best qualified to answer, and that is in regard to why we're doing this. Did I understand it correctly that chlorine has eaten away the steel beams and the cement, and the pool will and the pool floor will literally fall in 3 to 5 years?
That is possible, yes. We've taken some temporary measures to shore up the pool deck currently to ensure the safety of the people that use the facility currently. But in 3 to 5 years, those measures would not be sufficient, and we would not recommend that the pool continue to be used.
So from
pool facility as a whole.
From a safety point of view, the pool has to be, we either have to close it or do something about it.
That's correct.
Okay, thank you. And the second question I want to point out, and for those of you that have received the report on chart 4, there's a distinction between recommendation C, which is what I'll call the minimum to fix, and D, which is the minimum plus a few other things. And I'd like to point out and applaud Sue Weatherby, who has done a great deal of work on projecting revenues. And as David pointed out, the difference in terms, while it's significantly more expensive in terms of the $600,000 difference, in a cash flow basis because of the additional revenue, it's a nearly break-even decision, which is why I think the report says that in the long term, this is a good investment. Am I right in reading it that way?
Okay, that's correct. Speaking for the committee, I don't know, perhaps Dave would be better.
Yes, that, excuse me, that's exactly right, that the revenues that from an expanded facility, which includes a weight room, would offset the incremental cost on an annual basis. So we view that as a pretty good investment.
Just one comment that I have. Maybe this is to forestall some phone calls I might get at home. But it is my understanding from discussing this pool and being in other meetings that no one is contending that in any way mismanagement or poor construction of our pool when it was put in is responsible for the condition of the pool now. It's more a situation that it was state-of-the-art at the time, and it's been a long time, and there's been it's at near the end of its useful life, but it's nobody's fault. Is that a correct assumption on my part?
My name is Eric Greffin. I'm a structural engineer with Herman Associates. The corrosive process of chloride and salt on concrete is well documented. It's happening with pools all over the country and parking garages as well. And typically, those types of structures last about 20 to 30 years. And the time, unfortunately, is up. And you are correct that it was the state of the art at the time. The new solution we propose will last a lot longer because engineers over the country have learned a few things how to prevent what's happening now.
Thank you. Councilor Jordan.
What is, if a pool is taken care of, what is the life in your estimation of a pool?
The life of the pool as it currently is, we expect problems in 2 to 5 years. As the new pool, we replace all the concrete, not just patchwork, but all the concrete will be replaced. That could easily last 50 to 100 years, as long as the pool is maintained properly. The problem with the pool basin right now, this is the pool basin. There's water on the inside, but there is air on the outside. There is a duct around it. So the concrete is being attacked from both sides, from this side and from the duct side. What we propose is to basically put soil or dirt, sand around the new pool basin and bring the ducts out of the ground and bring them up higher. So that way you only have one surface to worry about, the surface you can actually see, and that surface will be treated with ceramic tiles. And a ceramic tile surface can last as long as it's in somebody's bathroom.
So I take it then that with this new pool, we get twice the life out of it?
Yes.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions? Councilor Fritz.
Just wondering if you'd expand a little more on what the community use is now, outside of the school use, and how much that might expand, and are you... Could you explain a little bit more where you're thinking this revenue could be made up from?
I'll attempt to answer that question, and if I fall flat, then Sue Weatherby's here to prop me up. But basically now, the school is the community services is providing certain programs that are centered around the use of the pool. The pool is available for open swim. There are lessons that are conducted there. There are competitive swim programs that are conducted there as well. And in a broader sense, with the combination of a weight room and a whirlpool, then there may be opportunity, there will be opportunity to bring people into that community, into that facility, rather, to use as an overall wellness program, much the same way individuals might turn to a commercial business, such as some of the places in Portland and South Portland, for use in staying in good physical condition. The pool in traditionally in the competitive sense, I think, had a pretty narrow focus, but now under the guidance of community services, they can expand the programs extensively, and something like a whirlpool could be used for therapeutic applications for someone, say, recovering from an injury, or potentially for someone who has a need for that application. And there is, as an example, a whirlpool in the South Portland swimming pool building that receives an extensive amount of use on a daily basis. A weight room can be used by the high school students. There's an increase in need for that, as well as for individuals, the elderly who wish to find a place to exercise that is close by, instead of having to drive to Portland or to South Portland to receive the same level of service. So I'm not sure if I answered your question, but again, Sue Weatherby's here if you need some more details.
So then we would charge for each one of those things, and that would...
Yes, right now the pool is generating about $32,000 worth of revenue annually, and in the option C that we've identified, which is largely an expanded pool program, perhaps open more hours, we would generate around $68,000 worth of revenue, and adding the weight room and the whirlpool to the mix then would allow community services to provide a broader scope of opportunities, and could generate potentially in the order of $172,000. And I might add that I think that those numbers are very solid and on the conservative side. I think we tried to be as realistic as possible, and to Sue Weatherby's credit, I think she did an excellent job coming up with some credible information in this regard.
Thank you. Obviously, we will have a lot to discuss at our workshop. Councilor Reed.
I just had one quick clarification. On that scenario you just described with the increased revenue, I think you said option C, but you were, in fact, describing option D.
I'm sorry. Thank you. Option D is the $172,000 scenario, not option C. Option
just
C
for
is
the minutes. And
thank you very much for correcting me on that.
They correct me when I do that.
Now, any member of the public that wishes to read this report, so you can come to Town Hall and read the report here.
I hope that the council can have a tour, and I don't know whether that could be open to other people who want to have a tour.
Well, we can certainly discuss that. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Is there a motion at this point in time from a councilor? Councilor Reed.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we receive the Donald Richards Pool Study Committee report dated April of 1998, and that we set a workshop date to review this material at a later date.
I second the motion.
Further discussion? Hearing none. All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Again, I know I speak for everyone on the Town Council, and thank all the members of this committee for a job well done. Okay.
No, I didn't. No, that's too much.
All right, moving on, item 127, receipt of the report of the Fort Williams Centennial Celebration Committee. It's my understanding that the chair of that committee, Al Barthelman, is here tonight. Here he comes. Welcome, Al. And again, this is an example of public service of our citizens. This is an exciting project, and I'm sure everyone at home is going to be as happy to hear about this as I was when I first heard about it. Go ahead, Al.
Thanks very much. Again, my name's Al Barthman. I live on Sawyer Road, the outer end, about as far away from Fort Williams as you can get. I still live in Cape Elizabeth. But I'm a big fan of the fort, and I'd really like to commend the whole group for their commitment to the fort, and thank the council for appointing us to the committee, because everybody really sees it as a tremendous opportunity. Before I start, I'd like to just mention the names of the people who are on the committee. Some of them are here, if they'd stand up. They're Jeff Barker, Clint Blood, Betty Crane, Don Evans, Sally Hinckley, Paul Phillips, Barbara Sanborn, who's our secretary, Jeff Van Fleet, Bill Wadman, and Dick Walker, who are in sunny Florida right now. Like I mentioned, our group is really committed to the fort and are excited about all of the ideas that have come both from the group and from around the community. We've been meeting since October 7th was our first meeting. We meet the first Tuesday of each month, and we have fun as well when we get together. The purpose of our presenting today is to give you an overview of our high-level plan of where we'd like to go and check in with you early in our process to make sure we're going in the right direction before we commit to more detailed plans. We're also asking for some initial funding, and it's also nice to be up here after we're talking millions to talk about a much smaller amount. We hope we can get that support to get started. It's also very appropriate that we talk to you tonight because it is April 13th, the 99th anniversary of the commissioning of the fort, exactly. So it'll be 1 year from today that will be the actual 100th anniversary. What I'd like to do is give you an overview of our plan, describe how we plan to manage to that plan, and then ask if you have any questions about where we're going. To start with, the objectives that we've come up with for the celebration are, there's four of them. First of all, obviously, to commemorate the commissioning of Fort Williams on April 13th, 1899. Secondly, we want to raise people's awareness of the fort as a significant part of Cape Elizabeth's history. Thirdly, we want to foster community pride by having people contribute to the event as well as attending it. And lastly, provide a springboard for the park's future through celebrating its past and enjoying it in the present. So those are our four objectives. The plan that we've come up with to achieve those objectives are really to start off on April 13th, next April 13th, with an initial event. However, we don't expect the kind of weather that we had today. And so we know that's a risky time of year to really plan a big event. So that would be pretty much to have some dignitaries commemorate the fort and start things off. After that, we see it as an ongoing series of things which keeps people awareness of the fort and its history going through the summer. Okay, we plan to do that by having articles in the Cape Courier, provide walking tours of the fort. Joel Eastman of the University of Southern Maine is working with us on that. Have the centennial recognized as various currently planned events happen, perhaps get our logo on them, have the centennial mentioned at the 4th of July concert, those kinds of things, and take advantage of everything that happens at the fort anyway. One of the ideas that the group has really taken to is the idea of an ice cream social. And what we would like to do is institutionalize the ice cream social and have it something that, with a local ice cream vendor, could be set up at each of those events and kind of remind people of the good old ice cream social. We would have things like three or four periodic band concerts during the summer, things like that. So it'd be an idea of keeping things in the front of people's minds throughout the summer at fairly low cost. The major event that we're proposing would be on July 24th with a rain date of the 25th. So we're really talking about a one-day event in that regard. The theme of that day would be past, present, and future. And we would start by activities which commemorate the military and the units that have served at the fort. We are looking into military bands and even the Marine drill team as possible people to come to that, have people walking around in period dress costumes, the walking tours and so forth, and then move into the present aspect of that day, enjoying the park in terms of some musical entertainment, food booths, activities for children, and those types of things, and wrap the day up with a laser light show, which is something that I don't believe the greater Portland area has ever had, and have a laser light show complemented with fireworks. Okay, so that's the past, present, and future theme for that day. One of the major events for that day would be to commemorate a display at Battery Blair, which is the battery just to across from Portland Head Light to the right as you're looking at the lighthouse. And some artwork was done 3 or 4 years ago by somebody that really caught our eye, and we would like to have this centennial celebration be the opportunity to actually create that permanent display. I don't know where I maybe would like to pass this.
You might want to hold it up for the people at home first.
Okay.
Is this to the right of Goresh?
Excuse me?
Right of Goresh Battery.
I'm not certain. It, as you're going down to the parking lot at the lighthouse, this would be over to the right, facing the field there. In terms of managing the overall process, we see the Centennial Celebration Committee continuing to meet monthly and having the oversight of the event as a whole. We are already and would plan to continue working a great deal with active groups in the community, such as the Garden Club and the Historical Society, who have been very helpful. And Cheryl Parker at the Lighthouse Museum has also been very helpful. So we would continue that and take advantage of volunteerism around the community. And we would also like to contract with a PR and event management people. We have talked to some people who could do that at very reasonable expense and could do it much speedier than those of us who aren't familiar with managing and organizing events of this nature, because we really want it to be a first-class event. The budget, as presented in our report to you, is extremely rough at this time, but we wanted to give you an estimate of where we're headed, a ballpark, and we could keep you updated as we go forward. It's a budget of $75,000, which includes the permanent memorial, so it's the permanent aspects as well as the celebration events themselves. Those expenses would be paid for hopefully with some seed money from the town to get started, but also through some minimal admission fees that we would charge, some fundraising events, and also by corporate sponsorship from some of the major events, such as the laser light show. It would be obvious things to have a corporation sponsor and get their name in front of the community. With that, that pretty well wraps up my summary of the report. If there's any questions, I'd be glad to take them.
Thank you very much. Again, this is the beginning of a process, not the end. This isn't a decision-making night. We anticipated, with the consent of the town council, that we would receive this report and expeditiously set a workshop where we could, in a more informal setting, discuss this proposal with your committee. But if there are any town councilors with questions tonight, please. Councilor Jordan.
Yes, I just want to ask a question to Al. I noticed in this sheet here of procedures, there seemed to be nothing indicating how it came into Cape Elizabeth, how Cape Elizabeth obtained it and what have you.
Oh, the transition of the fort into
yes.
the park.
So you don't want to get into that for this celebration? Or?
Well, when I think that one way to look at it is that we want to put the fort back into Fort Williams Park. And so we do want to acknowledge the park, and that's the present part of the past, present, and future. We have looked at one of the things that will be happening is Joel Eastman is interested in writing a history of the fort. And so that
would
be
good.
Yeah, and also the Cape Courier articles would be pulled from that type of history and would be elaborating on those kinds of things.
Are there any other comments tonight? Councilor McGinty.
I just had a comment. I've been following this closely. I think you guys have been doing a great job. I think there's been a lot of
input from a lot of different people on how to really celebrate the fort itself. I mean, I hate to date myself. I know Billy was probably here when the fort was commissioned, but it was I grew up over in that neighborhood, and it was still a fort when I was growing up over there, so I hate to date myself like that, but I think it's a great opportunity, and I think you people are doing an outstanding job, and I can't wait. I look forward to this a year from now to start the celebration.
Thank you.
I'd like to ditto those remarks, as they say on the radio. As far as the band concerts here, I noticed that, how long would they be, 2 hours, 1 hour? What's your thought?
The ones during the summer? Or,
yes.
Yeah, we were thinking a couple hours. The bandstand would be a nice place to have them, but some of the bands possibly wouldn't fit on the small bandstand, so we'd find another place.
Councilor Reed.
Yes, thank you. Al, I just wanted to know approximately when you expect your first expenditure to be needed.
We would like, I think probably our first expenditure, we did have someone work on a logo, and we'd like to give him a little bit of money just as a gratuity, but probably the event coordinator is the first person that we would like to contract with.
So is that a July 1st request, or is that more like a...
We feel at this point that we're on the cusp of needing to make some commitments quite soon. Some of the organizations, musical groups and so forth, really have a long lead time.
Right. So if we could, as you say, Mr. Chairman, expeditiously schedule this for a workshop, I think that would be very well done. And I will add that and the acceptance of this report from the committee in my motion when appropriate.
I just had one question about the ice cream social. Was that intended to be just when there are events that are scheduled as part of this centennial celebration?
Yes, we'd like it to be something that could be set up with each of the major events at the fort, but for those events specifically.
So it wouldn't be an ongoing thing?
That's not the plan now, right. No.
And you don't anticipate this being something that might continue other years?
All of our emphasis is on something for just this year, yes.
Councilor Jordan.
Oh, I just have an offhand comment. Just want to thank Al for the work he's doing, what have you, and I trying to get him involved with other aspects of the town in the future. And I want to know if you're going to have diet ice cream or...
Perhaps we should have the road race at the end of the summer instead of the beginning of the summer.
Councilor Reed, is there a motion?
Yes, sir. I would ask the town council to accept the report of the Fort William Centennial Celebration Committee and refer this to the next available workshop date.
Second.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor? Opposed? 7-0.
I just wanted one quick comment on it, but you skipped over me quickly. Speaking of expeditious...
Good taste.
That's right. This committee was due to present the report that they presented tonight by October 1, 1998. I think this is the first time that a committee has beat a deadline by 6 months. I really want to commend them on that.
Councilor Reed.
That's probably because they need money before October.
I was just being nice, Rosemary.
So was I.
Thank you, Al, and thank everybody on the committee. It's a great job, and we on the town council really look forward to working with you on this project. Item 128, receipt of comments from the Planning Board on proposed addressing ordinance. Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, the Planning Board did a very fine job looking through this. They held a public hearing, discussed a number of workshops, I think provided a number of important suggestions that can be reviewed by the Ordinance Committee, and I would encourage the Town Council to receive the report of the Planning Board and to refer this to the Ordinance Committee.
Is there such a motion?
I move that.
Second.
Second by Councilor Fritz. Further discussion?
I just wanted to ask a question. The form of their comments and recommendations is this is the sum of it in terms of recommendations. They did not do wording of the ordinance. Okay.
Further discussion?
Paragraph number 8, they said that the planning board opposes requiring street numbering across town lines, and I think that's a good point, that Ocean Street and Ocean House Road, Ocean Street in South Portland and Ocean House Road in Cape Elizabeth, although they're all Route 77, are two different roads, and I don't think they should have the numbers continuing from South Portland. We should have our own. That's all.
Thank you. Is there a motion?
We moved.
There is one.
Oh, we did it.
We have one.
Seconded. We just didn't vote. All in favor? Opposed? Passes 7-0. Item 129, approval of proposed lease at building number 324 at Fort Williams Park. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, we lease building 324 at Fort Williams to the Family Crisis Shelter for their administrative offices. The rent for the last few years has been $600. It's proposed to go, as of this past April 1st, to $750 per month, and then go up $50 per month each year until April 1, 2002, at which point it would be $950 per month. The lessee, the Family Crisis Shelter, also pays for all heat, electricity, and telephone service. So I would encourage you to approve the proposed lease and to authorize me to sign it.
Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
I have a question.
Move, one moment. Moved by Council McGinty, second by Councilor Jordan. Discussion?
Yeah,
Councilor Barry.
Mr. Chairman, on paragraph 2, it says to hold for a term of 5 years and 1 month, commencing April 1, 1998, and ending March 31st, 2003. Where does the 1 month come from? That looks like 5 years.
Maybe because it'll take us be a month late in renewing it again. I think that's just language left over from the previous lease, and we'll make sure we delete that before we sign it.
And on the second page, it says that the premises will be in the same condition as it was when they took it over. Reasonable wear and tear expected. I think that what they mean is accepted.
Accepted.
That should be changed.
Yeah.
We do expect reasonable wear and tear.
Could be either way. Yeah.
I would amend my motion to include those changes.
Second.
And finally, what is the amount of insurance? In the final paragraph, they say that the lessee will hold harmless and identify the lessor from any liability arising from accident and so forth. I just wonder if we shouldn't set an amount for insurance for liability that would... I want to protect the town from any liability claims. So we have, I understand, an office here that is not where the battered people stay. It's not a shelter, it's an office. So probably we won't have the same kind of situation that might occur at the shelter. However, I think the town should be protected by an amount of insurance. I would suggest, what, half a million maybe?
But just as your previous two points were, that this is, it's an excellent point, Councilor Barry.
Thank you.
The town does not have a consistent policy on what we do require for insurance. This issue does come up from time to time, and none of our leases state it, but I think it's very much a good point and something I will review with the town attorney, not only for this lease, but for all the different operations of the town and when we have other parties come in.
Right.
We typically require certificates of insurance, but we don't have specific amounts. So
in my line, I have to have $1 million, and it's not awfully expensive for the town. The premium for high limits in this type of situation is not prohibitive. And I think that would be good for protection of the town.
Is the current language acceptable, that as long as it's acceptable to the town manager?
Sure.
Fine. All in favor of the motion? Opposed? 7-0. Item 130, approval of bid for sewer rehabilitation work at Cottage Farms neighborhood. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, the town council has looked at this, I think, at two previous workshops, one meeting at which it was authorized to solicit bids. The low bid for this work came in at $148,165. Including contingency and construction monitoring, there's a total budget of $171,275. I recommend that you authorize me to sign the contract with the low bidder. who's Leland P. Murray and Sons, Inc., and we set as the budget $171,275, with all funds coming from the sewer fund trust balance.
Is there a motion? Councilor Jordan?
I'll move that we accept L.P. Murray and Sons as the contractor for the sewer project.
Is there a second?
Second.
Councilor Barry? Discussion?
There were two or three, Mr. Chairman, there were two or three options or choices here for contingency, and I wonder why. If we have approximately $15,000 for inspection, surveying, and testing, what else do we need money for?
The total $171,000 includes the funds for
right.
For the testing and the
right.
the inspection. There's an additional 5% proposed here for a construction contingency. This is when you run into ledge and other, particularly ledge is what it usually is.
Well, does the contract require that the job be done according to specification?
According to specification, but once in a while we find out that the specifications were not aware of something underground. Is that proper English? Yeah.
Close enough?
Yeah, they find some extra little piece of pipe that needs to be put in, something like that. It's very typical. We don't usually spend it all, but it's good to have it there so that if some citizen has some problem along the way that we want to address, a stone wall or something we oversaw that's in the affected by the construction, this allows us to promptly respond to that citizen.
Further discussion, Councilor Jordan.
Well, I was just interested how many bidders you had.
I believe there were four.
Okay.
There were two bids in this general range, and there were two bids quite a bit more, to more than 50% more than this bid.
Councilor McGinty.
Do we have a projected completion date for this project, do you recall?
I don't recall exactly. It was in the bid documents. We asked for start and end dates, but I don't recall.
This summer?
It's during this construction season.
Further discussion? Hearing none, call a vote. All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Item 131, acceptance of amended easement for Dyer Pond Weir Access Road. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, a weir is a small dam that holds water so that in a retention area so it doesn't flow too quickly. This weir has been particularly good and effective in helping a lot of drainage problems in the Delano Park Shore Road area. There is an access road that goes to it. It was recently discovered that the access road is not actually in the easement area. This is a corrective easement that would provide that the road that's there would actually be covered by the easement. There's about to be a home built up in there. The land around it is still privately owned, and that's how this happened to we happen to become aware of it.
Is there a motion? Councilor Reed.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we accept the corrective easement.
Amended
easement on the Dyer Pond Weir access.
Is there a second?
I second it.
Councilor Barry, further discussion?
If it's okay with Mike Hill, it's all right with me.
Councilor Fritz?
Just a comment that the map that's presented here is kind of difficult to comprehend where this is located on the face of the earth. And I mean, usually, like with the planning board, we would have a location map and, the subdivision, and so that we could zero in on where this really is. I mean, this is very difficult to.
It's Offshore Road.
Yeah.
Dyer Pond Road.
I mean, I assume that's Dyer Pond Road there, but it's certainly not clear by what we've been presented.
I'd be happy to take you down there. When you're there on site, it's extremely clear because there was a road constructed. In order to build the weir.
Mm-hmm.
And as always, we have our packets ahead of time, and if we have questions like that, I'm sure the town manager is always available to assist any of us. Further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Item 132, approval of warrant for municipal election. Our town clerk.
I'm recommending this evening that the council sign the municipal election warrant for the council and school board seats that are up on Tuesday, May 5th at the high school gymnasium. This is not to be confused with a warrant that you signed last month calling for the special referendum election on the town center petition.
I shall move.
Second. Further to any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor? Opposed? Passes 7-0. Item 133, approval of appointment of ballot clerks.
As my memo indicates, every general election year, parties appoint or actually recommend ballot clerks to work at the elections, and I would recommend that the council approve these nominations as presented.
So move.
Second?
Second.
I have a question.
Discussion.
How many clerks do we appoint? Is there a number? Is there a set number? Is it?
Are you talking about for individual elections or for this?
For any election. For this election. Is there a set number? I mean, there's a number.
It's not a set number. No, the political parties can
nominate as many
as they want.
Okay. So, thank you.
As are willing to serve.
Further discussion? Hearing none. All in favor? Opposed? Passes 7-0. Item 134, approval of appointment of member to serve on the Voter Registration Appeals Board. Ms. Lane.
Thank you. The Voter Registration Appeals Board does have a vacancy that was left by Frank Gooch, who moved from the community. He served as a Republican Town Committee Chair. We find that that is a very good makeup for this board. The new chair of the Republican Town Committee is Bill Beyer. Bill is willing to serve. Since this appeals board was formated in 1995, it's never met, and I don't anticipate it to do so.
It's Bill's kind of job.
Be knocking on wood.
I said he would accept if they don't do anything. So I would recommend that you appoint Bill to this term.
They also serve and only stand and wait.
Is there a motion?
No move.
Second.
Second.
Second. Lots of discussion? No.
Yes, there is discussion on this. I have a problem with this. I'm not so sure that we should have a sitting town councilor sitting on this appeals board. And there's no reflection on Bill at all whatsoever. But the fact that this person could make decisions regarding who's on a voting list, who's not on a voting list, that could present a potential conflict of interest if that person is potentially for or against that candidate or position, a referendum, for instance. And again, no reflection on Bill whatsoever. I just have a problem with a sitting town councilor who may have power over putting people on a voting list that could have an impact on his election or somebody's for or against or whatever. And, you know, maybe it's that's very philosophical, and the fact they've never met before maybe has no meaning whatsoever, but I just have a philosophical problem with that.
Joe? Just so that everyone understands, Debbie asked me to do it, and I said I'd be willing to do it. I have no great zeal to do it at all, and would be happy not to and get somebody else, and that's fine with me. So I'm not.
I'm a member of his party, and I mean, I voted for him to be, you know, chairman of the town committee. So this is absolutely no reflection on him whatsoever. I think it's just a matter of potential perceived conflict of interest.
Yep.
That's all.
Not a problem as far as I'm concerned.
Why don't you put a Democrat in there? Wouldn't you have a real conflict?
Say that. Okay. I already have the chair of the Democrat.
I'm trying to see my way around the conflict issue in the sense that you're concerned, just so I understand the conflict, that at some time when anybody, it doesn't have to be a town councilor. I mean, anybody that's ever running for elective office or contemplates running for elective office has an opportunity, theoretically, by serving in this position to stack or decide who can vote and who can't. But the problem in appointing anybody It has nothing to do with town council, per se. The problem, it would be the same as appointing anybody, and if they then ran for elective office, it would be your position they'd have to resign this position? Because it doesn't have anything to do with town council. It's just an elective office. Is that what we're saying here?
I would say so, yes. Yeah. I just don't like, whether it's sitting or not, or a candidate, sure, that. It just seems to be a conflict for me.
Do you need somebody tonight?
No.
I would make a motion we table this item.
Second.
All in favor? Motion's tabled.
Sorry, Bill.
Yeah.
I don't mind. Matters not to me.
Item 135. Authorization to install commercial vacuum at the refuge disposal area. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, this first came about as a suggestion of a citizen back in September of 1996. It's been looked into and studied, and we actually found a vendor who could provide the service of providing a commercial vacuum cleaner at the refuse disposal area, and it's a, even better than that, it's a Cape Elizabeth company. What would happen is the vacuum cleaner would be installed by this company. We would provide the slab and the electricity. This company would then, for providing the vacuum, would keep 60% of the proceeds. We would keep 40% and also be responsible for cleaning the immediate area around it. A lot of folks go up to the refuse disposal area with brush and other materials in their vehicle and would like to have the opportunity perhaps to vacuum it. It does need to net at least $50 per month that it'll be removed. And if it's found that it nets a lot of money, we could put in additional vacuums. But this is a policy issue. There are other commercial vacuums in the community, and we were hesitant to go forward and place these without the authorization of the town council.
Is there a motion? Councilor Reed.
Yes, but then may I have a little discussion? I move
that... Didn't you make a motion?
Make the motion.
I move that we authorize the town manager to have installed coin-operated vacuum cleaner, or plural, at the transfer station.
Second.
Immediately.
Second.
Second now. Councilor Reed, discussion.
Yes, just in light of the fact that I was the councilor who sort of shepherded this through in only 19 months. just because I have a little bit of an understanding of how busy people are when they go to the transfer station, but also how much they might want to have a clean car, I would ask the council and the town manager's indulgence at perhaps understanding that people might not be patient enough if there's a line of two cars or three cars to use the vacuum cleaner. And in light of the fact that there's a minimal outlay and the expected profit is low, that we could have two put in at the same time where we would have somebody seeing somebody vacuuming and seeing an open vacuum and would therefore vacuum their car. I know this sounds so funny, but it's not.
Well, Mr. McGovern, is there any indication from the vendor that he would be willing to put in one or two or three or whatever you want? Is that the...
I have not spoken directly to the vendor. Mr. Malley has. My sense is he wants to be sure that this is going to be a going operation for him. I think Councilor Reed's comments are on point, and I'll speak to Mr. Malley and suggest that he speak to Mavco Incorporated to see if they would be willing to install a second unit. And even if they're not at this point, we will put the pad in and have it so that a second one could go in just as soon as possible if it's found that the first is inadequate and he's not willing to install the second immediately.
Councilor Barry.
Mr. Chairman, has any estimate been made of what the electricity will run? I know that some places it's expensive.
We anticipate it'll be far less than our percentage share of the the vacuums. You know, this is not something we're doing for profit, though we may make a slight profit. It's really being looked at as a convenience to citizens.
As long as it carries its own weight.
It will.
So my understanding of the current motion is machine or machines, so that if it's possible to put in two, the town manager is authorized to put in two. It's only possible to put in one right now or only put in one. Is that acceptable interpretation of the motion?
And that if a second one is appropriate, say in June, that it can be done without coming back to the council.
That's my understanding of this motion.
And that a second one being put in would not cost more than $200?
I think it would be slightly more than 200, because the slab will need to be slightly larger.
But that wouldn't be that much more.
We're in that ballpark of money.
I guess the only other thing I was concerned about was the proposed area right near the Goodwill drop-off box, whether that's already pretty crowded with people at the returnable shed and the swap shop.
Bob has looked it over quite extensively and feels comfortable that there is enough room there so a car can pull over. You know, the good thing about it is the car has to be very close to the vacuum cleaner.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a real control as to where they park. The hose only reaches so far.
Further discussion. Councilor McGinty.
I'd just like to commend Councilor Reed for her persistence in this. I know she's been on her agenda for a long time, and I definitely support it. Always have.
Thank you.
Hearing no further discussion, call the vote. All in favor? Opposed? Passes 7-0. Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Is there any such discussion? Hearing none. Item 136, request to enter executive session to discuss the status and negotiations with Cape Elizabeth Police Benevolent Association. This might be or could be followed with possible action. Is there such a motion?
I so move.
Second?
Second.
Might make mention of the item.
Mr. Chairman.
Also, there's item 137, request to enter executive session to discuss land acquisition disposition matters. Can that motion and second also encompass that item?
Absolutely. Makes good sense.
It is possible that we will be back tonight in public session with action on one of these items. It's not necessarily so. I am reluctant to have the...
If the cameras won't stay on, but if anyone wishes to hear the results, if there was a vote and the result of the vote, can give us a call in the morning. And for those who are interested as well, I will be calling the dispatcher and leaving a message there. And if anyone wishes to call the non-emergency number, they can do that.
All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. We're going into executive session. Good night.